Hello, I'm Michael Baer, Community Science Director for Ocean Sanctuaries. In recent years, two revolutions have been occurring at the same time, the citizen science revolution and the artificial intelligence revolution. Although you could say that citizen science has been around since the days of Darwin, since he had no formal degrees in his field and pursued studies of evolution out of personal interest, it has also been more or less in the last 5 years or so that citizen science has really come into its own as an academic discipline. Citizen science, or community science as it is sometimes known, has been using data gathered by laypersons under the supervision of scientists to monitor everything from butterflies to bird populations to water quality and astronomical anomalies. Ocean Sanctuaries was founded in San Diego in 2014 to promote marine citizen science for both the general public and for divers. We offer tide pooling programs for the general public, shark tracking for divers, and as we shall see later on in this presentation, artificial reef monitoring for divers also. So the backstory for our partnership with Thriving Earth Exchange is that Ocean Sanctuaries had been actively engaged in marine citizen science, both with the general public and the diving community since 2014. And we had four active marine citizen science data collection projects already going. Since the definition of citizen science is non-scientists partnering with scientists to gather and analyze data, we were looking for scientists to partner with to ensure that we were following proper scientific protocols. After coming across an application on the Thriving Earth Exchange website, we applied and were accepted. So, how did we select the project for our partnership with Thriving Earth Exchange? Well, Ocean Sanctuaries and a small select group of experienced divers and underwater photographers had already been collecting data on marine life on the Yukon since 2015. So we felt that as a project with a long-term data set, it would make an ideal focal point for a scientific partnership. So the backstory on the Yukon is that in the year 2000, the city of San Diego, in collaboration with the San Diego Oceans Foundation, purchased, cleaned, and sank the 366-foot-long Canadian warship called HMCS Yukon to create an artificial reef off the coast of San Diego, a task at which it has been spectacularly successful. In the intervening years, it has attracted dozens of marine life species and has become a revenue-generating attraction for tourist divers from around the world. So one of the reasons we had to be careful in our selection of divers to collect data on the Yukon is because they had to be certified to 100 feet, which is considered an advanced dive, and they had to be comfortable taking photographs in less than optimal conditions, such as low visibility and strong current. And also access to the Yukon was by boat only, so that always had to be coordinated. So obviously, the first step in any scientific endeavor is to ask ourselves, what scientific question are we asking? And then the second question would be, what tools will we use to answer that question? So the question we are asking is, what marine life had made its home on the Yukon since its sinking in the year 2000. And we decided to use the well-known citizen science tool, iNaturalist, which is one of the world's largest flora and fauna databases maintained by the California Academy of Sciences, with data collected from all over the world by citizen scientists and exported to the Global Biodiversity Information Facility for later analysis. So the methodology used would be considered diver selected species or random encounters. Transit lines were not used at this depth as they were considered a safety hazard. So we used random diver selected species, which of course is subject to species bias. So some of the challenges involved with collecting data at this depth are obviously the extreme depth of the dives themselves, which are subject to things like nitrogen narcosis. Also cold temperatures, with the average temperature of 55 degrees. Strong currents, sometimes very low underwater visibility, and we had to limit our dives to no decompression diving only, which limited our bottom time. And then of course there was also boat access, which was dependent on the availability of boats. Over a period of 5 years, from 2015 to 2020, divers were able to make 237 photographic observations, recording 59 species, which were verified by iNaturalist. So to wrap up, why is a scientific partnership a good idea? Well, for one thing, scientists can help you design study protocols, assist with post-study data analysis and quality assurance for possible later peer review publication, and they can also help you with community outreach ideas.